So I would like to thank Anne and the School of Architecture at Waterloo for, first of all, inviting me to teach here, which is a really amazing opportunity, and also to come and talk about my my own work, which I have to say, standing in front of a School of Architecture may finally, I hope, end these recurring nightmares that I have, in which I get a call from the administration of my own School of Architecture telling me that I'm missing 4 credits and that I have to return and finish 5th year because I didn't actually graduate. So standing here before you is like possibly proof finally for my subconscious that I am an architect. So I want to talk about where I come from. First of all, my training in architecture, and also I trained as a classical musician as well for actually quite a lot longer when I was a kid than I ended up studying architecture for. And so I've always had an interest in a parallel interest in music and sound, and that's where. When I met Emmanuel Madan, who's an electroacoustic music composer and who also worked a lot in radio, we really found some common ground that we thought would be worthwhile exploring at the intersection of architecture and music, if that's possible. So this sort of area of intersection between these two very disparate disciplines is our locus of investigation, and it tries to occupy that in-between space while strictly belonging to neither. And I mean, I feel quite particularly happy about this very fruitful collaboration, because in preparing this lecture, I had actually forgotten that despite the ties that we were nominated last year for this year's Governor General's Award, which is for us a tremendous, tremendous honor. So the first work that we did together was the Symphony for Dot Matrix Printers. And before I get into all of the works that I'm going to present tonight, one of the things that I was exposed to while I was at Carleton was the teachings of the philosophy of Merleau-Ponty. And phenomenologists in general. And I just read a phrase from Merleau-Ponty, which is really, I think, the key to understanding what I try to get at in the works that I make. So the real is a closely woven fabric. It does not await our judgment before incorporating the most surprising phenomena or before rejecting the most plausible figments of our imagination. And so all of our work together, and my work as a solo practitioner, as an architect and as an artist, has been really attempting to cling on with all my force to the real and to the objects of the real world that we inhabit. And so the Symphony for Dot Matrix Printers, it started about 3 days after I graduated from architecture school. Emmanuel and I decided we would work on a project together, and the idea for the project was some recordings that I'd been making, some spatialized recordings of a typewriter. So with some microphones inside a typewriter, you can actually hear this sort of gigantic machine moving around you if you listen to the spatialized recordings. And I got talking with Emmanuel, and he's like, oh yeah, I've always wanted to make some music with some dot matrix printers, you know, get a whole bunch of them, put them on stage, hit print, and you know, away we go. So we tried that. And what was surprising in retrospect is that it took us only 48 hours to gather, like, more than we could possibly ever use to answer this, because this was like junk at that time. It was when the inkjet printers had hit the market and nobody wanted dot matrix printers. It was like a hole in the head. It's like all that noise they make and terrible, terrible paper and all the rest of it. So we got all this stuff for free. And we gathered it together, and we brought it to this room, and we, you know, put some text in, and we hit print, and the result was absolutely atrocious. It was like awful. But what we realized is that these devices are It is possible to apply a symphonic metaphor, because if you treat or think about these devices as an instrument, when you print something, they always create the same set of noises based on what is being printed. So, in essence, the printed text which is generated when the machine is printed, or the text file that goes into that printer, is actually functioning the same way as a score does for a musical interpreter. So we quickly realized that by manipulating the text that we were putting into these machines, we could actually use them with compositional intent. So rather than just generating noise, we could actually generate tone and rhythm and go at them as a real compositional instrument. And so this is sort of the basic premise behind the Symphony for Dot Matrix printers. Is we create texts of our own where we've abandoned the linguistic meaning of the text itself in favor of the concrete acoustic results that it makes while it's being printed. So this is a sample of one of the scores for one of the printers in the orchestra, which together play some what we like to think of as radical techno music. So this is a very fast section. This is basically the rhythm. The rhythm is given by the width of the total width of the characters that are being printed, and then tones are generated and rhythms are generated based on groupings of other characters. If you've got more points, more dots in the matrix that are being printed, you generate more noise, and generally speaking, a lower tone. So this is another score for another section of the piece, which is a very, very slow sort of, we like to think of it as a string section, where this is a wide carriage printer as opposed to a narrow carriage printer, so we get more travel in the carriage. And the other byproduct, if you like, of these dot matrix printers is, of course, all of the stepper motors that are used on the inside to drive the carriages and rotate the drums, and those also make noise. So by using a vast collection of microphones, you can sort of zoom in on various spots inside these mechanisms to pick up individual noises that are being generated by, say, that motor or this spring when it gets returned or something like that. So if you were to start from the bottom here, this piece of music is tick, 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 then it starts to get more complicated. Tick, 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 etc. So, having realized that we could zoom in on these micro tones, micro sounds being generated by the mechanisms, we composed this, you know, half an hour of piece, half an hour of music, which was incredibly labor-intensive, but I'll get to that in a second. So to expand this symphonic metaphor, so we now have an instrument, we now have a score, and then we have a PC computer, which is acting as the player of the instrument, and then we have a conductor, which is actually a network server, which is distributing print commands to the various PCs, which are then printing their text fragments of text files on their printers. And that allows us to synchronize and orchestrate a piece of music for multiple printers at the same time, while staying in the realm of the junk world that we found, as opposed to, say, making recordings and going to the studio and making sampler music. We decided that we would actually sample the whole technology, like the space of the office, and sample that physically by using these devices. So this was, we first made Symphony No. 1, and we would show that a couple of times, and people would come up to us afterwards and say, oh, that was great, but how did you make all of the music? I'm like, oh, God. So we quickly realized that we needed to do the same thing with cameras as we were doing with the microphones. So there are cameras inside the printers capturing the movement which is causing the sounds that you hear when the piece is played. So the piece of music, the symphony number two there, is about 40 minutes long, and it's each individual part of the score is each like part for the musicians is written in a text editor using a DOS computer, and then the synchronization file, the master score, if you like, of the scores is also written with a text editor on a Next computer, from which is like Apple's, like Steve Jobs' side project when he left Apple for a bit. And I conservatively about 6 months of work to like trial and error tease out music from these like recalcitrant beasts. So the next obvious step from the performance was doing this in installation. So we took our orchestra of printers, and we made what we thought was a clever title of the Office Suite for 15 dot matrix printers plus video switcher. Because the individual video cameras inside the dot matrix printers, you need to change the channel in order to be able to generate the sort of music video aesthetic that we wanted to have to accompany our techno music. And the question is, how do you do that without buying at the time $150,000 worth of video gear to like beat sync the image switching to the sound? So we came up with the idea of actually channeling the video signals physically back to another a wide carriage dot matrix printer, and then putting in contacts inside along the drum of the printer, and then moving the carriage to actually physically switch the channel. So that means that we can physically switch the channel of the video using the same like text system and control system that controls the rest of the instruments. So we have this like music video device to beat sync the video switching to the music, which remains entirely and sealed in this like junk aesthetic world that of reappropriated obsolete office technology. So you can see the sort of video projection in the background, and of course during the performance, and that is also generated live with no pre-recorded stuff at all. The trouble, of course, with the installation version is it has to run for 8 hours in a gallery, and we quickly realized that our unique collection of 15 dot matrix printers, some of which we have never seen twice, was not going to tough it in the gallery environment for an installation of like 6 months. So that was the first and only time that we did this piece called the Office Suite. We then moved to a piece called the Quartet for dot matrix printers, where we take two wide carriage and two narrow carriage printers, which you can actually still purchase because they're used in industry, because it's still the cheapest method of printing. And they are, you know, you, the You've probably heard dot matrix printers at the airport because they still use them for printing passenger manifests because it's cheap, and the ink ribbons last forever, basically, by comparison with laser. So I'm totally delighted about this image. This is a presentation we did at the Quartet in at the Shanghai Biennale. And I can't really think of two more disparate worlds colliding than like this ironic repurposing detournement of consumer technology confronting this guy who's, you know, knew what it was like to live under Mao in rural China. This is just totally intense for me. Moving right along to something completely different, but the same somehow, this is the Xylophone project, which we were actually listening to one of the byproducts of at the beginning, when in the background. That was a piece of music that Emmanuel and I made before we actually did this project, where we use loudspeakers and microphones to excite the natural resonance frequencies of the Silo Number 5 building in the city of Montreal, right downtown. So Xylophone is essentially the outcome of my thesis project, and it's what I wanted to do right after leaving school, but there was just no way that I had the money to do something like this, because this is like a big building, and you kind of have to operate at a certain scale, and for that you need budget, not free dot matrix printers. And this is just an amazing building complex. It's started in 1905 and finished in the 50s. And it's a grain transshipment and storage silo, which would receive grain from the prairies coming in on the Laker boats up the canal, up the Lachine Canal, and store it temporarily before it was put onto ocean-going vessels for export to Europe. And in the mid-90s, there was a small change in the subsidies policy for grain shipment, which meant that it was like $1.50 a ton cheaper to export through Vancouver as opposed to coming through Montreal. And so they just turned off the lights one day, locked the door, and said, okay, that's good. 1995, it's been empty ever since, and we are the only tenants, along with Bell Mobility, who uses it as a cell tower since 2001. So the structure of the building is basically 88, or the section that we're interested in, which is the most recent concrete section, is an agglomeration of 88 reinforced concrete cylinders, which are 100 feet high and 25 feet in diameter. So it's 30 meters high, basically, and 8 meters in diameter. And on top of those cylinders are some conveyor belt floors, and at the bottom the same thing. And then in the tower at the end here, this is the actual elevator part that brings the grain up to be distributed along the work floors here, and then dropped down into the bins. And in between those 88 cylinders are another something like 132 interstitial bins, where they fill in the little pie-shaped bits between the cylinders. So one of those will be a full cylinder, and then the next one over will be just a piece of pie left over between the two round cylinders themselves. And so The acoustics inside this building are absolutely phenomenal. The cylinders have a reverb time of somewhere in the region of maybe 45 seconds, 50 seconds. And just to put that in perspective, the Taj Mahal is about a minute and a half. So we have a pretty, you know, serious piece of music gear sitting right in the heart of the city, into which we inserted loudspeakers and microphones. And so just to put this in perspective, this is looking up from the bottom. That little rectangle there is that trapdoor. These things are really, really, really big when you get inside them. So this is the loudspeaker. Rather than the microphone, and this is the loudspeaker up there. You get a better view of it here. And so what this allows us to do is to transmit sounds from outside into the acoustic space inside the building, capture the results with the microphone, and then retransmit them to their origin points. Because we were not going to be allowed to bring people inside this building. That was like an insurance no-no. This project turned out to be mostly an administrative one rather than an artistic one, because we had to wrangle a lot of people and a lot of, like the Port of Montreal owns the building. It sits next to land owned by Parks Canada. There's a railway line that runs through it that belongs to CN, and the whole sits in land which is owned by the other Crown Corporation, the old Port of Montreal, which is next to the City of Montreal. And we needed to run cables across everybody's land. It's just a nightmare, total nightmare. So what the project, the kernel of the project is these threefold sound collectors. One is a telephone line where you could actually have a conference call inside the acoustic space inside this inside the cylinder. Another is a website where you could upload a sound, trigger it so it's broadcast, and then it would be streamed back to you in pseudo real time over real audio. And this is like in year 2000, so you know this was like high technology back then. And then the third channel is this installation, which is just opposite the silo building, which is we call the Observatoire Sonore, the Sonic Observatory, which has a column with a microphone and two columns with loudspeakers, and then a little publicity slash promotional slash propaganda poster where we try to instill the what we believe to be the intrinsic value of this silo building in the minds of the people who are visiting the old Montreal, the old Port of Montreal. This receives a lot of visitors, maybe 2 million in a year, something like that. So we get this foot traffic, and we try to get across to them that the industrial infrastructure is part of the heritage of Montreal and not something that needs to be demolished to make way for condos. So the proposition that we're trying to put forward is that the silo is a monumental building, terribly important to the history, industrial and architectural of the city, in the line of the Bucky Dome back there, and of course habitat right there. Thank you. put the website interface into a gallery to allow people to trigger sounds directly from a gallery space. So the website still exists. The technology is getting seriously old, like web technology from 2000, which hasn't been updated since because we have no budget to do so, is finally reaching the end of its life. So you can go there, but sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. And we're in the process now of trying to totally redo all of the technology so that the project can exist online as the largest interactive musical instrument in the world for another 10 years or so, we hope. So this brings me to the project that is a solo project of mine, which I started after the Silo project, which is called Ondulation. And there were really two points of departure or questions that I wanted to address with this piece. And the first was the problem of representation that we ran into with the Silo. Like, the very first experience that I had going to the Silo building was actually rappelling down inside those cylinders and making some music actually inside the space, because that's the only way that you can actually access them at that point, was by descending with a harness. And it was just mind-blowing experience. It was really amazing. It's pitch black, like there's an inch-thick layer of dust on the walls, so that if you touch them, you just get covered in this white grain dust. And then there's this incredible acoustic that you've just, you know, rarely experience. And there is just no way that you can get across that kind of experience through, you know, video or by piping in audio and piping it back out again. So the project is sort of a way, it allows you to get a channel into the building to put in a familiar sound and hear it transformed and sent back to you so that you have an idea of what it must be like, as opposed to an actual reproduction of the experience that you could have if you were allowed to go inside. So Ondulation is a reaction to that, in that I wanted to be able to, deal directly on a direct level with the audience and an experiential level, to create an experience which could not be represented and it cannot be transmitted because it's created in front of you for you specifically. And this was as a result of seeing James Turrell's works in the Mattress Factory in Pittsburgh, which is completely changed my thinking about how art needs to be made, that it needs to be actually located inside the viewer, the perceiver, as opposed to taking place outside on some canvas surface or like in a structure. So that's just the first question. So Ondulation rests on the supposition that sound is physical. It's ephemeral but solid, and as one of the many facets of perception, irreducible and resistant to representation. And the other question that I wish to address was the one of the performer in contemporary music, because you see a lot of performances, especially in electronic music, where you have somebody sitting behind a laptop and you have no idea how what you're listening to is connected to them. It could be playing back, it could be programmatically generated, it could be they're doing some kind of manipulation. You don't know, because the gesture that connects the traditional performer to the sound that you hear has been lost once you introduce this technological device in the chain or digital technological device in the chain of reproduction. You know, even the electric guitar, you hit the strings and you get a reaction. You can see this very, very clear connection between the body and the sound created. So what I wanted to do is to create an instrument that would stand in for the role of the performer. It would become the body of the performer, that would be manipulated by myself as the creator of some electronic signals, but which would actually behave in physical space to replace my presence on stage. So I created this basin of water. This one is about 3 meters by six. Inside the basin, there are some very powerful, specially constructed loudspeakers, which transmit sound and cause the water to move. And then onto the surface of the water, we project beams of light, carefully controlled, so that those beams, the reflections, are manipulated by the waves which are created on the surface of the water and create images as a result. And the images are really quite They're quite, you know, striking if you can see them for real. Like, these aren't retouched or anything like that. These are just like photographs of what's produced by this phenomenon. And so this sort of brought in this idea of condition, neurological condition of synesthesia, where you have a simultaneity between senses. So chromesthesia is one of the more common forms of synesthesia. It's where colors are ascribed to sound. And Nabokov and Liszt and a lot of well-known people were gifted, possibly, with this synesthesia. And more recently, Jimi Hendrix talked about chords and harmonies as if they were colors. The famous purple haze refers actually to E7 sharp 9, which is like the chord which is used to play purple haze. So he saw this sound as having a color, which is a really interesting, idea. So ondulation there's a triple synesthesia going on. There's a sound wave, which is acting in the audible realm. The sound wave is causing a water wave, which is acting in the tactile realm. And then that tactility is being transformed into a visual wave, a light wave, a modulation of an image on the screen. And the three are indissociable. The sound is causing them all, or the image is necessary or necessarily implies the sound. So this, even though it looks computer generated, is real. It's a basin which is 6 meters by 10, with three of these loudspeakers in it. And this is seen from a bridge which runs over the top of this particular theater space where this was presented. Show this kind of stuff, but because this is sort of outside of the context of the normal presentations that I give, I thought that perhaps I would talk a little bit about some of the process behind the kind of work that we do. This was a performance we did at the Châtelet Theatre in Paris, And we had, usually it's like a week to set up the piece, you know, takes time to put the thing together, and then it needs to be tuned in its environment. And this had to be done during the rehearsals for a musical that was being shown at the Châtelet at the same time. So we only had one night to set up. So there was a big crew of people. And this gives you an idea of the complexity of the thing that's being shown. So that was like a crew that had practiced setting this thing up so we could get it done in the time available. And so, I mean, roughly speaking, this is a very precisely crafted aluminum structure so that we can get a level surface to within half a millimeter over the entire perimeter. So it's an infinity pool, essentially, but it's a temporary infinity pool, which has to be able to be struck and put into road cases and shipped to the next gig. And still hold water long enough to actually do a six-month installation. And this is actually the place that made me the most nervous of all the places that we've shown, because at the very beginning of this, let me go back again, sorry. At the very beginning of this, you see the stage moving, and that underneath there, in this section, oh, it's too late. It's gone. There's a $250,000 Steinway grand piano. So if there's like one leak in this thing, that piano is gone. So I asked them to move it. So after Ondulation, the project that we did, we've done a number of other small projects, but you know, in terms of the big projects that we really engaged with, the Coincidence Engine series in homage to Gheorghe Ligeti is the next one that I want to talk about. So Ligeti was a Hungarian composer who escaped from the communists after the Second World War and established himself in Darmstadt in Germany, and was very active in that scene and also in the Fluxus movement in Germany. And as a side story, there's like this very believable, credible rumor that the CIA was funding the composers at in Darmstadt to counteract like the fascist tendencies that German music had demonstrated during and pre-Second World War, which, if it really is true, is absolutely the best use of CIA money ever. Funding the Fluxus movement, really? That's just too cool. So Ligeti made this piece called Poem Symphonique, which is a composition for 100 metronomes. And this was a really important reference for Emmanuel and I when we first started working together, because it uses metronomes not as a timekeeping device, but as like for musical ends. And so this was the kind of strategy and gesture that we needed to really embark on the project of using the printers themselves as physical sound generators, as opposed to sound sources that could be recorded. So Ligeti's piece is, the Poem Symphonique is 100 metronomes, which are pre-wound to a certain degree of the tension potential of the spring. And they're started before the audience comes in. And the row at the back are set to fast, then these ones are sort of medium pace, these ones a little bit slower, and the front row the slowest of all. So the spring winds down first in the ones at the back, and then gradually that progression moves towards the front. But because these are analog devices, you have no idea when that is actually going to take place, the winding down of the spring. And it sounds like a deceptively simple kind of Fluxus piece. I mean, that was what he was doing at the time. And he got commissioned by, I think, Belgian television to make a new piece. And it was premiered by Belgian television. They recorded it. They hated it so much that they put away the recording, and it was found like 30, 40 years later in a tin in the basement with "Do Not Broadcast" written on the top. But I think this piece is absolutely, it's absolutely stunning. I mean, I sort of just thought of it conceptually, but then we restaged it when we were in Holland, and this thing is powerful. We restaged this every 20 minutes, and the place was packed every time we did a show. And the reason why it's so powerful is because there's this tremendous, well, first of all, this is a very unexpected thing that happens. When you walk in with the metronomes already going, you start with this tremendous cloud of sound. You can't distinguish an individual. I mean, it's like, you know, a field of crickets or something like that. You can't distinguish an individual source, a noise source, just this cloud. But as the mechanisms start to wind down and the sound sources start to thin out, you start to perceive like the possibility of rhythm and the possibility of there being a relationship between between the individual noises that you're starting to hear. And it winds down a little bit further until you end up with maybe, say, eight, and then it really is rhythm. And it crosses this threshold between being incomprehensible noise and towards this sort of, it gives the perception that it's been constructed and is music. And then gradually, there's only two left. And then that one of those two stops, and as you're left with this last one. And there's this tremendous pathos when you anthropomorphize this last goddamn metronome on the stage, and it's like people start crying. It's amazing. It's totally, totally shocking to me. I was really not expecting the piece to be that powerful. So, what we decided to do, I go on like an hour-long lecture now about our investigations of time, because this is really what the metronome for us is about. It's a divider of time, and time is a human construct and has a history, a very, very interesting history. And metronomes are a significant part of that because they were, along with the tuning fork, they were really the part of the modernization, the modern project, as it applied to classical music. So you end up with the standardization of tuning between orchestras and the standardization of timing of scores. Before that, there was just some words. It's like, you know, play it fast, play it slow. But the metronome allowed you to give this precise definition to how fast the piece should actually be played. So we decided that instead of using metronomes, which are like seriously expensive, because they're made in Germany and there's only one company that makes them still, we would use something a little bit less costly, because we like free and less costly things. So we went to IKEA and we bought one of every clock that they have. Because where do you get stuff for your house these days? The answer is only IKEA. And it turns out that IKEA doesn't make 40 different clocks, they only make three, because they buy their movements in reasonable quality, medium quality, and absolute crap quality, and then they put a face or a frame around that movement and call it a clock, and, you know, charge you somewhere between, in this case, $1 and up to like 40. And we're like, a dollar, eh? That sounds good. So we called IKEA and we said, you know, this is kind of interesting. We would like these clocks. We've been to all of your IKEAs on the South Shore and on the outside of town on the East End, and we've like cleaned out the shelves. Can we get some more? And the trouble with these clocks is that there's one nice one, the black and white one, and there's three like hideous colored ones, which are like sort of pink, rose, and like green, purple. It's just awful. And we're like, but we only want the black and white ones. And like, yeah, no, we won't do that for you. It's like, look, we'll go to the warehouse and we'll sort them for you, and like we'll take the white ones and we'll repackage them. It's like, no, we don't want to know about it. So what do? We'll look on the back of the clock. It's made by Rita, which is actually a Korean company, but assembled in China. These are Korean parts which are assembled by Rita in China. And Rita make these clocks for IKEA, and they make basically any shameless idea of a clock that you could possibly imagine, Rita will make it for you. So we called them and we said, we'd like a few of these. So you have to figure here that that IKEA is charging you a buck. It's going to cost 33 cents at the factory, because it's 33 cents to purchase your stuff, 33 cents to deal with shipping and marketing and warehousing, all the rest of that stuff, and then 33 cents profit. That's sort of the general goal of what they're trying to do with this stuff. So 33 cents at the factory. We negotiated a bit. We weren't buying quite as many as IKEA. So, you know, the price came up to about, I think, like $1.20, but shipped air freight to our door in 2 weeks, built from scratch, packaged individually in a plastic bag and bubble wrap and a cardboard box and multi-packed in another cardboard box. If you would do the same thing here, this piece of technology is probably about $25, I would think, to make. In China, 33 cents. So we got a couple of these things. About 1,250 in this particular installation. And they're ranged on this sort of amphitheater of styrofoam, which is the other Chinese material par excellence after plastic, like hideously toxic, doesn't ever degrade, and you know, you sneeze and it gets dented. Like, it's a terrible, terrible material. So we really like this idea of expanding Ligeti's initial concept in space and time and number. Or contracting in space, I suppose, and concentrating the experience onto one person, so you can walk inside this construct, which focuses the sound for you, and the combined ticking of these 1,200 clocks is approaching the sort of noise level of a dishwasher or something like that. Also, on a side note, all of the clocks show exactly the same time at the start to the second. Like, it takes about 12 hours. Or 20 man hours to actually set them all, and then they start. And because they're crappy clocks, they start to drift with respect to each other. And so when you walk in from one day to the next, the sound is never the same because the emphasis falls at a slightly different point in the 2 second rhythm, which is the basis for the clocks, because they make a different sound when they tick from when they talk. So the first piece in the series is called Universal People's Republic Time, which is a reference to the poor people in China who had to make it, and this idea of universal time zone. And these things are coincidence engines. Coincidence engines is a sort of double meaning, that coincidence of happenstance, but also co-incidence, co-locating the source of sound with its production element, rather than broadcasting sound by reproduction through loudspeakers. That's about the same volume as is produced by the actual piece when you're standing in the center of it. So the second piece in the Coincidence Engine series is the antithesis of the first. So Ligeti was really fascinated by this confrontation of determinism with indeterminism. And the symphony piece, the poem Symphonique piece, is a really good example of that. We move from something which appears to be a cloud of sound, entirely indeterministic, to something which appears to be a deterministic, ordered, rhythmic sound at the end of the piece. And he constantly came back to the writings of Karl Popper and these ideas of determinism and indeterminism and the confrontations of trying to produce a cloud-like sound from machine-like instructions or machine-like sounds from cloud-like instructions. So this piece is an entirely deterministic version of the prior one. Instead of having zero control of the piece after it's begun, in the first piece we have control over the start condition and we know what the end condition is going to be 6 months later when the batteries die, but in the interim it's entirely indeterminist. With this piece, we have total control over each of the 100 elements, or 98 rather, in the instrument that we built. So instead of having that little quartz crystal inside the clock, we replaced that with an impulse from a controller, which sends an electric signal to advance the stepper motor, which actually moves the second hand ahead by one half rotation. So we can actually control when the second tick actually occurs. And that second tick is reinforced by an LED light signal, which picks up the sound of the ticking and blinks. So this is approximate demarcator of constellations in other cosmos. The metric for this is very different, obviously, from the first one, where there isn't any compositional method. But the strategy is the piece lasts 12 hours, and each clock must tick within a 1 second window, which means that all 98 clocks will tick at some point during every second period, which means that in aggregate they remain on time. One doesn't gain time with respect to the other, and at the end of the day the time is still correct because they're beating, they're slightly dephased by up to 1,000 milliseconds plus or minus, but they must tick every second at least once. So this is a 12-hour composition in bytes of 1,000 milliseconds. So this is a pretty complicated machine, it turns out, because when you take one of these things and modify it and produce a controller for the stepper motor, that's okay. But when you need to build, 98 with enough spares to last for the lifetime of the piece, things quickly get out of hand. So we turned our studio into a sweatshop to experience what it's really like working in China. And the process of manipulation of each clock, each one has to be disassembled, some parts have to be removed, other parts have to be added, and there's probably an hour and a half going into each individual clock. Plus, we don't even got to the electronics yet. So each clock has a controller board, which drives the stepper motor now, and each one of those boards had to be handmade. And then the controller boards for the controller boards also had to be fabricated, and never again. So the result of all of that work is six panels of 16 of a clock, a loudspeaker, an amplifier, and a controller, and an LED driver. So what this allows is to co-locate, once again, the sound reinforcement with the source of its signal. So we developed this idea of the auxel, like the pixel. So it's like one individual sound reproducing device. So we co-locate the loudspeaker right next to the source of the, as close as we get to its individual source. Very, very different project. Portrait landscape machine. This is was a commission from an organization in Toronto who's going to remain nameless because we're no longer on speaking terms. And portrait landscape machine is this very, very simple idea. It's a lot like the xylophone in that it proposes an open container which can be filled by the general public. This is our idea of how interactive art should work, is that we offer a channel in the same way that YouTube has ended up working in many ways. But, you know, back in 2000, YouTube didn't exist, and so this was sort of, you know, in new territory to be exploring. But what we find interesting about the possibilities of interactive art is what people can actually bring in a creative way to the project. So portrait landscape is essentially consists of this, you know, conceptual device, this 3D printer, which prints in sand, and it prints three-dimensional portraits of the public. And the idea is that this would occur in a public space, and the portraits would gradually accumulate to fill the public space, and of course erode with the elements, the rain and the wind and the sun, and disappear, as a kind of metaphor for our ephemeral existence in the cities that we habit, inhabit. You know, we pass through, cities remain. So the other thing that we liked about this is the playful association that sand has. You know, the sand castle is a space of play and very lighthearted material to be using, but also essentially free again. And the only material that we use other than sand is water. Water is the binder which we use to actually make the sand castles that we're constructing work, just like on the beach. So we built this large-scale prototype 3D printer. This is our Russian constructivist engineer, Rene, from Holland. And we borrowed some technology from the oil, gas, and mining industry, which is it's called a hydrocyclone. And what this is for getting the crap out of your oil. So when the oil comes up, it's spun inside these centrifuges, and the sand goes to the edges of the cone and then drops down and falls out the bottom. So we're turning it on its head. We don't care about the water which is going through this device to carry the sand. We care about the sand coming out of the bottom. So what would usually be the bit thrown away is for us the bit which is important. So we attach this hydrocyclone to a 3D printing gantry, and then using another piece of technology from the mining industry called a jet inductor, we could actually suck sand into a very, very fast, high volume stream of water, and use that water carrying the sand to transport it through the machine and get it to the print head where it needs to be, where it's essentially concentrated by this hydrocyclone and then deposited on the print bed. This is the very first time we've actually got this thing to work. And the discovery that we made is that there's sort of multiple ways that you can actually use this thing. The real sort of rope thing structure on the base is quite different from what is ending up now occurring on the top, where the contact between the nozzle of the hydrocyclone is now being essentially closed when the sand has filled the space available. So we end up with these sort of maybe 2/4 size as our, it's like 1/4 stacked on top of the other, as our minimum resolution with this particular size of hydrocyclone and nozzle. And so using this and, you know, just open source software for slicing up solids, we can do exactly the same thing that you do with a 3D printer for plastic, but in only sand and water as the medium, which is quite significantly cheaper. So, I mean, aside from the goals of the project, which were to reproduce 3D scans of random people with the machine and leave them, you know, on the sidewalk. So there's the scan and there's the final product. And now he's been flattened a little bit in the Z dimension just to speed up the testing that we were doing. You know, you can see that results are quite compelling even at this scale, and the idea is to make it, you know, significantly bigger. But the organization that shall remain nameless changed their artistic directors. And the new artistic director used a loophole in the contract to get out of actually finishing the commission. So we have this like lovely prototype printer, which is like built from parts which are not really intended to do the final job, because it was our intention to build the real thing with the ultimate budget, which we never received. But I think that this technology has lots of different applications. We did a bunch of research while we were doing the development for this project at other strategies to use 3D printing to build buildings, and there are a number of those. But this one, I think, is a rather unique direction and could potentially be explored for architectural purposes as opposed to art purposes. So the last work that I want to talk about is another commission from for the new Louvre-Lens building in northern France. The Louvre-Lens is a Sana architects project, of course, who did the museum in New York, among many other currently celebrated works of contemporary architecture, along with a landscape architect called Catherine Mosbach. And this is in Lens, which is a very, very hardcore working class industrial town, very poor, very high unemployment rates, formerly made its money from mining, but now there is no mining. And so this is a piece of land over the top of the mine exits, which is essentially a plinth of all of the overburden that's discarded when they're extracting what they the coal from the ground. So you've got this sort of platform raised up above the rest of the city on which they decided in their wisdom to build a new Louvre. And then there's this marvelous landscaping around, and that's the sort of sketch site plan with the entrance building over here and like the various halls. And this is the result, and it's like this, hyper minimalist, very, very delicate building, which was intended to reflect the landscape of the landscape architect and sort of mirror it. And it's sort of like this, you know, building as reflection of Arcadia, into which we were brought and asked to make a pavilion to house the Ondulation project, which the president of the region of Nord-Pas-de-Calais, who were paying half of the bill for the new Louvre Museum, wanted a copy of. And I said, sure, you can have a copy of it. You know, it's X amount of dollars. I'll sell it to you tomorrow. I have one at home. And he's like, no, but I need a pavilion for it to go in the garden at the Louvre. I'm like, oh, shit. So you've got the administration of the Louvre, which is, you know, like possibly the world's best known capital C cultural organization on the one hand, and you have some like hyper control freak minimalist architects from Japan on the other, and it's funded by a socialist party, the president of the local socialist party who likes, you know, talking about soccer at his fundraising events, and at all other points in every conversation he can get, you know, soccer into. And how on earth are we supposed to come up with an architectural proposition which is not going to be just ixnayed immediately by any one of these, you know, three very politically potentially dangerous non-clients? And we just, you know, we just like drew a blank. Like, what are we going to do? Like, these people wouldn't, the SANA wouldn't even allow a tool shed to be built on the site, like, you know, like way out there past the ends of the trees. No, that had to fit within their design aesthetic and had to be designed by then, the tool shed. So it was like, how are we going to do this? So I went back to a strategy that I employed when I first had a job in architecture at the clinic at Carleton, where students would help out people in the summer doing, you know, work and drawings for permit applications for their suburban extensions. And the strategy that we had for that project, well, those projects, was always there were three proposals. There's the ultra-conservative one, there's the ultra-radical one, and then there's the one that you want them to choose. So this is the conservative one, which is like, you know, it's a nice building. It's like, it's sort of delicately sited in the landscape, not too far away from the entrance building. And it's, you know, makes an appearance, but it's sort of, you know, not too in your face, and subtle materials and some water elements and stuff like that. You know, there's the section, and it's like partly embedded in a hill to sort of modestly hide the flanks of our modest pavilion. And that's the, of course, the conservative one, which we know they're not going to choose. And then there's the radical one, which is like this crazy pavilion within a woven basket of fiberglass rods, which sits on this like very dramatic reflecting pool, which is sort of behind the building. It's like, you know, this is like not gonna fly. And there's the, you know, section and plans, like fanciful. I had a great time designing it, but it's like, you know, from the first sketch that this will never, ever, ever be built. And then what we actually came up with, the exterior of the building, well, looks like that. It's the same reflecting pool, which was on site anyway to like feed the sprinkler systems. This is the plan. And essentially we hid the building completely underground, because this is like an architecture of self-effacement was the only strategy that we could come up with as a way that we were going to get anything built within this like politically difficult situation. So that's the plan in the section. This reflecting pool above, and the stairway which descends through the level of a reflecting pool into this interior room, which is like custom designed for the Ondulation project. And this was accepted by the president of the region, and it was budgeted. And then the Louvre turned it down because they didn't want to pay for security guards in perpetuity. So it's not going to get built. Thank you.